One of the first things every schoolboy learns is that water flows to its own level. The water beneath us is motionless, but we're 500 feet above the sea, 500 feet high in the Pennine Range, on a voyage between two seas. I'm Pete Morgan. Our skipper is Stuart Sampson.
Out for a bit of fresh air.
Yes.
Do you want me to take a turn on the
I'm happy for that, thanks.
Yeah. I don't blame you, it's a lovely day.
It's definitely nice.
The prospect of linking the East and West Seas with a waterway was the first dream of the canal age. But the physical act of getting a road of water over the roof of England proved to be the most complex engineering problem in British canal history. The problem was surmountable. The Leeds and Liverpool Canal had two great water engineers, John Longbotham, who planned it, and Robert Whitworth, who cut the most difficult central section. The Legger's Hut is a clue to Whitworth's technique. When he came to a hill, he went straight through it. It was Whitworth who planned the Foulridge Tunnel.
At first he was optimistic, too optimistic perhaps. He wrote that the tunnel would be a small affair and as easy to execute as any that had been executed. In the event, it took 5 years in the making. And when the tunnel was opened, on the 1st of May, 1796, it had cost, in labour alone, £24 a yard.
The tunnel was cut without a towpath. In the old days, the boats had to be legged through by two leggers who worked from that hut at the tunnel mouth. Leggers lay on their backs in the boat's bows and walked the vessel through the tunnel using their feet against the walls. There have been four collapses in the mile-long tunnel since it was opened over 180 years ago. The warning beam across the tunnel end shows how low the roof has sagged in the middle of the stretch. Foulridge Village is a good place for a lunchtime pint. Moor up here, near that hole in the hill, visit the pub called the Hole in the Wall, and you find evidence of one of the waterway's strangest stories. In 1912, this cow fell into the canal near the Legger's Hut. She swam the mile from west to east, where the innkeeper brought her round with brandy. If the Foulridge cow had swum much further, she might have made a fisherman's story, another big one that got away. She might have made history, the first cow to swim across the border.
And this is it. County Brook across there marks the Lancashire-Yorkshire border. I've never crossed the boundary this way before, and I must say I'm relieved to find that there's no ritual involved, not like crossing the equator. From now on, it's Yorkshire all the way.
The Leeds and Liverpool is Britain's longest single canal. It rises high above the sea. Thanks to its length and the height it climbs to, it has the greatest variety of scenery. Today, our boat, the Lady Galadriel, becomes a naturalist's floating hide, but nothing bothers to hide from us. Thank you. That was mink from the nose to the tip of the tail, and nature showing the cruel streak beneath the calm tranquility. The Anchor Inn, the first pub in the White Rose County. It was once an important commercial centre where the landlord spoke the language of the cut. In those days, the traders of Salterforth put out notices beside the bridge. 20 tons of coal wanted. Have you lace from Leeds? Today, we have neither coal nor lace and no excuse to stop for ale. We slake our thirst on cool reflection. As a lad, I played on the banks of the canal, but it never occurred to me to wonder where the water came from. In fact, the Leeds and Liverpool relies on hundreds of natural streams and natural rainfall to feed its man-made lakes. The lakes hold the water in the hills, where it makes a leisure facility, a natural wildfowl breeding ground. But to get the water to the canal involves an intricate web of draining troughs and gravity feeders as complex as the canal they were built to supply. The summit level has always been plagued by water shortage. At Greenberfield, diverting the path of the canal helped the engineers to halve the amount of water needed. That was in 1820. Now the bridge across the stable shows where the old cut used to run. Water loss is no surprise. Each time a lock gate is opened or closed, upwards of 50,000 gallons flows from one level to the other. The last of the Greenberfield locks marks the beginning of our descent of the Pennines. The way down is more gradual than the steep climb up. After Greenberfield, we're into a setting of wild and empty uplands. Up here, there's peace, tranquility, and mile on mile of green. When you look at a landscape like this, you begin to understand why walking the towpath trod has become a popular leisure activity on the banks of England's waterways. But here at East Martin, the walkers are not out simply to admire the landscape or the achievements of engineers like Longbotham and Whitworth.
Hello.
Hello
there. Are you going far?
We're in the Pennine Way. Finish the tea there on Sunday night.
How much further is that though?
60 miles.
60 miles.
So you've come out far? We've
gone to 10.
Best of luck. Cheers.
The Pennine Way. 250 miles of trekking trail down the backbone of England. For a mile or so, the towpath becomes a vertebrae. The Leeds and Liverpool isn't known for the magnificence of its bridges and aqueducts. It was built for use rather than ornament, and the most photographed bridge on the Leeds and Liverpool, the double arch bridge at East Martin, is purely functionary. The bottom arch shows where the pack horse travelled. The top arch was built when they raised the road, the turnpike from Burnley to Skipton. Whenever I travel on that road, the A59 along the Ribble Valley, I roar across the double arch bridge with never a thought for what's under the wheels. I never stop the car to look, but I'm happy to moor the boat. Today, the moorings are full to the brim. So are the glasses in the Cross Keys Inn, the only pub for miles around. Leaving the village, the paths diverge. The walkers make for higher ground. The water makes for the woods. Although we have left the village behind, we haven't left the name of Martin. This is Martin Pool, a 5-mile stretch of lock-free water high in the Pennines. Martin Pool is a prime example of the contour canal, the early system of canal building which avoided expense by hugging the contours of the hills. We may be within shouting distance of the boat that's ahead of us across the fields, but it will take us up to 20 minutes to curve round to the point where they now are. To the first people who lived and worked on the canals, the length of the route and the time it took was inconsequential. It didn't matter to them then, and it doesn't matter now. It is easier to fill a hollow than it is to excavate a hill. Out of that simple principle of contouring came the Priestholme Aqueduct to cross the River Aire. Our first encounter with the river, which will grow beside us as we roll along deep into the Aire Valley, and nature close beside. Thank you. This canal is one of the few British waterways which still boasts its movable bridges. There are few, if any, of the original swivel bridges in existence. The early ones were built of wood, not steel, but the principle remains the same.
Cheers, that's fine.
Originally, the movable bridges on the canal carried farm tracks, minor roads. It follows that when you find a swivel, you know you're close to the works of man. You tend to forget that the route you travel is also a man-made artifact, once the motorway of its day. The aim of the waterway was simple. It was built to make a road of water from one town to another. Today, that water has become commercially obsolete as our needs have changed. Now we want our metalled roads to travel not through towns, but round them. But as we pass, we doff our hats to the achievement of our 18th century forefathers. We dress a concrete wall with stone below the curve of the Skipton bypass, which roars our traffic round the town. The concept of building a bypass around a town would never have occurred to the canal planners. They wanted their water right at the center, where there was trade and commerce, and where there were people. Because the canal was built to service industrial premises, the main use of canal-side buildings and land has always been industrial. The 18th century navigators, the navvies who actually dug the Leeds and Liverpool canal, had one prime aim: to get their waterway straight to the heart of whatever town they were passing through. Here, in Skipton, they cut the town in half. When the canal arrived in 1773, two boatloads of coal were sold for half the normal price. The bells were set ringing in Skipton, reported a newspaper of the day. It meant you could travel from Skipton to Leeds by water, far better than the stagecoach. But no passengers ever came this way, up the half-mile diversion that opened 1 year later, up to the springs behind Lord Thanet's castle. The cut is still called the Springs Branch. When they dug the cut to the castle, it was the age of Sam Johnson and Napoleon. Leeds Mill reminds us how things were. Inside, the water from Ellerbeck still drives the wheel, and the wheel still grinds the grain of Yorkshire into flour. When the canal company built the Springs Branch, they sacrificed the castle moat. To navigate the half-mile stretch in summer's heat is like navigating jungle. A boat up here is a rare surprise. Lord Thanet, a major subscriber to the Leeds and Liverpool Canal Company, was still a miner when they built the Springs Branch. His agents knew their business well. They wanted the water behind the castle where the limestone quarries were. Under the towering castle walls, the derelict loading chute is the last remnant of an industry that lasted for over two centuries. That chute is recent history. Originally, the stone was dropped straight to the boats from the castle staves, 100 feet above the water. Desorme, henceforth, reads the motto on the wall. After a 3-year siege during the Civil War, Oliver Cromwell allowed the restoration of the Norman castle, but insisted on decastellation. Many's the time I've called in here, but it wasn't until recently that I learned of the hotel's significance. It was here in 1770 that they held one of the first public meetings of the Leeds and Liverpool Canal Company. Skipton still retains its importance as the market town the name refers to. The Anglo-Saxon skip means sheep. Skipton, sheep town. The name is apt. Every time I travel out of town, I always seem to run up behind some convoy carrying sheep through sheep from a market to a market. No such holdup on the water. When they built the cut, they built through open country. Now it has become crowded into submission behind houses, cinemas, factories. The view is different from the canal. New angles on things you thought you knew. On the road, we could be bumper to bumper in the enforced company of people leaving or arriving. On the canal, we can choose the company we keep. On this leg of our voyage between two seas, we have boxed the compass on our meandering journey over the roof of England. Now we keep the bows due east as we follow the path of the Aire Valley, deep into the Yorkshire heartland.